So it's a real pleasure to welcome Laura Lippman, a native of Baltimore, back to Politics and Prose this evening. And I believe this is the fifth or sixth time we've had her with us. And it's always a wonderful evening. Not only does Laura have a fantastic ability to really connect with her readers, but she also thinks of us, the humble booksellers. Last time she was here in 2014, during the release of After Undone, she sent the staff a cake, which is still discussed in reverential tones in the break room to this day. So, Laura, thank you very much, and you'll always be welcome here at Politics and Prose. Laura's latest novel is Hush Hush, and it's a fantastic read and a book that makes an impression long after it's been put down. I think that Laura's strength as a novelist comes, among many other things, from the strength of her characters. They're always three-dimensional, they're often relatable, they're occasionally murderous, and they're never dull. Of course, many of you here this evening will already be well aware of that, and I'm very pleased to say that Hush Hush is every bit as captivating and beautifully written as her previous works. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Laura Lippman.
Thank you for a lovely introduction. I'll go right at the elephant in the room. I am recovering from a cold. I sound awful. I don't feel awful. I might even have an amazing coughing fit while I'm talking to you. Just, it's okay. It really is. I'm so much better than I was. I got sick 2 weeks ago, the day I flew to New Orleans from Mardi Gras. And I actually put myself in bed for most of Mardi Gras. I missed Mardi Gras. I missed Lundi Gras. I watched with great pride as my 4.5-year-old daughter got dressed on Mardi Gras Day and came home with 4 coconuts from Zulu. 4, if y'all know what that means, it's a really big deal. And my kid is amazing. She is quite the, she's quite good at getting all the Mardi Gras graft. So anyway, don't worry about my voice. It sounds bad, it's not bad. A week ago, I literally could not sit up in bed. So I'm pretty happy to be here. So Hush Hush is the first Tess Monaghan book, really the first original story to me since 2008. How many people here have read Tess books? I hope you're happy. So why did she go away for so long? It wasn't a plan. In 2008, I was asked by the New York Times Magazine to write what would become the final serialized novel in the New York Times Magazine. It's a really good gig. It was a really lucrative gig. For me at the time, the big question is, as someone who was already writing a novel a year, could I write the novel I owed by the end of the year and write this serial at the same time? And I talked to a couple of other writers who had done it, Michael Connelly and Ian Rankin, and both of them said, oh, you should do it, because when you're done, you can basically repurpose the material into a novel. You know, so it's really this like great double dipping. I got a new kitchen. And it's interesting because the Times required of me something that I don't require of myself. They required that I outline the serial. And it was great. It was the single most joyous writing experience of my life because I would get up every day and I would know what I was going to do. You would think that this would then inform all of the writing I've done since, but it doesn't. I don't outline. Even though I had this experience of it made it so much easier and it was such a positive experience, but part of the reason it was a positive experience as well is because in 2008, I was pretty sure I was going to be a mom soon. And it gave me great joy to write this book in which Tess Monaghan is on bed rest from a difficult pregnancy. Immature writers imitate, mature writers steal. I was stealing. I was very upfront about the debt I owe to Rear Window and Daughter of Time. I was so upfront about Daughter of Time that it is literally in the pile of books next to Tess Monaghan's bed. And I just thought it was a wonderful device, and I enjoyed the heck out of it. The only problem with the story was at the end of it, Tess had a baby. Happens when you're on bed rest for a difficult pregnancy, I guess, if things turn out well. And I didn't have a clue what to do. I couldn't even do what my friends had advised me to do and repurpose the material into a longer novel. I didn't see it that way. I was like, no, this was meant to be about 40,000 words. Anything else would be padding. And so it was published in, I believe, 2011 as a trade paperback original, which to my surprise, and I think really to my publisher's surprise, actually hit the New York Times bestseller list, I think in large part because it receives so much support from independent bookstores. And I know that people in independent bookstores just hand-sold the heck out of it. And, you know, it was fun. It was little, relatively. It was a trade paperback. It was less expensive. It was a good place for people to meet Tess Monaghan. The only problem was she wasn't coming back anytime soon. Why wasn't she coming back? It wasn't a plan. But the problem was is that I now had a private eye with a kid. Now, I think, about as feminist as you can get. But I'm well aware that we do have biases in the way that we consider people. And I felt that after all this time, first Tess Monaghan novel came out in 1997, that I knew a lot about the Tess readers. I certainly had been hearing from them a lot in the years that Tess did not appear. And one thing that I felt very strongly is that these readers, while they had watched Tess grow up, while they had first known her as a very impulsive young woman with who sometimes made poor decisions, who sometimes took risks she shouldn't, that they would find that hard to accept in her as a parent. Do I think that it is harder for us to accept a female private eye taking risks than a male private eye? Yeah, I kind of do. Maybe that's just me, and maybe I'm talking about my own sexism. But at any rate, so on the one hand, you have this form, the mystery novel, the crime novel, which does indicate that stakes should be kind of high at the end. But on the other hand, you have a character with a small child. What will readers indulge? What will they tolerate? You know, you dread that phrase that you see so much on the internet, which is, I threw the book against the wall. You know, I didn't want people throwing my book against the wall because they felt like Tess was a bad mom. Now, for 10 years now, I've been teaching for 1 week every January at a writer's conference that is held at Eckerd College in St. Petersburg, Florida. It is actually open to anyone who wants to apply. You do have to apply. You do have to submit a manuscript. But it is 8 days, and part of the reason I teach there is because it's just one of the greatest things in the world. Dennis Lehane was the co-founder of the program. I came in year two. He recruited me by talking to me at a conference and saying, I would really like you to come teach in this program. And I said, you know, Dennis, I don't have an MFA. I don't have a PhD. I took two creative writing classes in college, which I did pretty well in, but that's, and I've taught at Goucher College as adjunct faculty, but I don't have the credential. And he said, yeah, it's really simple. Our main criterion for people to teach in this program is you can't be an asshole. I said, I think I can do that. And I'm actually really proud of the program because over the years it has created a core faculty that includes Stuart Onan, Anne Hood, Andre Debuse III, Les Standiford. It has brought in what we call the guest stars. A lot of our guest stars became full-time faculty. Andre Stuart and Anne Hood all started as full-time faculty. Tom Parada is golf number one. Oh, they sound so bad. So anyway, I'm really proud of this program. Jess Walter was the guest star this year. We were like, oh, Jess will come back because we really liked him. And so over 10 years of teaching, I find that I learn as much as my students do. Sometimes I say to my students, if you're learning half as much as I'm learning, you're really getting your money's worth, because I come out of it every year really jazzed up. And one of the things over the years I found myself telling my students, you'd see a manuscript, and there was a really big problem. And they were trying to like write around it. They were trying to write so beautifully that you wouldn't notice it. They were trying to pretend it wasn't there. Sure, these characters would completely do things that made no sense and didn't follow any of the things we knew about them. They were trying to really shoehorn plot into a receptacle into which it would not fit. So So I said, look, you got a problem. It's not going to go away. You can't paper over it. You can't pretend it's not there. You have to address it. And sometimes the way of addressing your problem, go straight at it. Make the problem the book. Make the problem the story. And I finally took my own advice, and I realized that the way to write about Tess Monaghan as a mom was to write about Tess Monaghan as a mom. Now, as I mentioned, in 2008, I thought I was going to be a mom really soon. Man plans, God laughs, if you know the old saying. Didn't quite work out like that, although it now, I thought, you know, within a year. It was 2 years later that I became a mom. And I should mention here that I think, I'm not going to say I'm unusual, but I have very clear boundaries about advice. If I don't ask for it, I don't want it. Now, my friends know when I ask for their advice, they can tell me anything. Anything. I am not the person who says, I want your advice on that, and I get hard advice, and then I pull a pout. I don't do that. When I ask for advice, I am completely open to hearing anything. When I ask. When I don't ask, I don't want to hear it. I mean, really, I really hate advice. I mean, like, I don't want someone in the grocery store to talk to me about what I'm buying. I just don't want advice. This may be a byproduct of having a father who is an editorial writer. Sort of on the one hand, on the other hand, you know, having a parent who is trained to be a devil's advocate can be somewhat traumatic. And then I became a parent. And it turns out that people give you advice all the time. Strangers. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe how many things I could do wrong in, you know, the span of time it took me to visit the local coffee shop. I was always doing something wrong, according to someone. Now, early in my mother-to-be phase, I got those books, you know, What to Expect When You're Expecting, and I didn't read any of them, because to tell people, basically my experience with most books that were about having an infant was it was like fear-mongering, 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 don't forget to breastfeed, fear-mongering, 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 fear-mongering. No, you really can't breastfeed, even if you're not the biological mother, fear-mongering, fear-mongering. I was a mess. I was like, I can't read these books, I'm having nightmares. So I wasn't very open to advice as a parent. And I realized, though, that having become a parent, I was going to be getting a lot of it. And I was being judged all the time. And generally, I was being judged to be a failure. It was a really interesting experience. And so all of that begins to be string for the book. What's the book really going to be about? I mean, Tess is a mom. You can call it the B story, you can call it, you know, sort of the subtext. It's not going to be the core, the spine of a murder mystery. And I began reading a lot and thinking a lot. I should pause here and tell you that I think having ideas is my job, right? It's my job to have ideas. And I don't like to be mystical or airy-fairy about it. I don't go walking in rainstorms and wait for the muse to fill my body. I mean, I sit and I consciously think about, what do I want to write about? What could it be about? You know, I read, I just start reading and thinking. One day, and I know I've told this story before, but I never get tired of telling it. I was at an event in Montgomery County, and it was for writers. And there was a somewhat famous writer there. I'm always very honest about it. This writer snubbed me. I'm not a very nice person when I'm snubbed. I get kind of peeved. So I was angry. You know, I was like, I thought this writer was really rude to me. And I thought it was, you know, very impolite behavior. We were, you know, on this at the same event, sharing the stage, and I thought the writer could have had better manners. And so the writer got up to give sort of the keynote lecture, and I found it to be the most unhelpful thing I'd ever heard for a group of people who had come there to find practical solutions to moving their own writing careers forward. Because what they were hearing was this really hippy-dippy, ethereal, follow your bliss, try to write close to sleep, coming or going. Don't write in the same place too often, it will lose its magic. This writer happened to have a famous parent. Like, my famous parent used to go from the gazebo to the hammock. I might exaggerate slightly. At any rate, I did find it to be sort of antithetical to what I thought the job of a novelist is. I just don't think we should make it sound so mystical and out of reach. The one thing I know about fiction writing, it is within everyone's reach. I'm not saying everyone will do it well. I will risk public censure by saying, despite whatever technology is wrought, I don't think everyone should publish. But I do believe writing fiction is within everyone's grasp. We are storytellers. Narrative is the human language. Some of us do it better than others, but if you have a story in you, I think you should try. And I don't think making it sound magical or dusted with, you know, fairy dust is of any help. So I'm sitting there listening to this talk and I'm so irritated, and let's be reminded that I'm a very petty person and I'm really mad at the person giving the talk. This is probably not incidental. If the person had praised me lavishly before she went on, I probably would have thought it was brilliant. But at any rate, I thought, how do I counter this talk, which I feel is so wrong? Like, we don't get up and denounce the person who's talking. What I did is I pulled out a legal pad and I decided to brainstorm myself to a novel before the speaker finished. Like, really, what interests me? I like old crimes in Maryland that no one's ever heard of. My favorite book is Lolita. I've been thinking about this. And what about that? And what about that? And what about that? And, you know, I'd said that one of my little thought bubbles was, I'm interested in old crimes in Maryland that no one's heard of. I am very much influenced by crimes that happened when I was young and made a big impression on me, but are, you know, the Lion Sisters, which were the core of what the dead know. And in this case, I remembered a case from my teenage years in which there was a serial killer who kidnapped his victims, raped them, and then killed them, with one exception. There was a victim kidnapped in Baltimore, and the serial killer kept that victim alive and took that victim with him when he kidnapped his next victim, raped and killed that victim in front of the penultimate victim. And I'd known that story my entire life, and for the first time I thought, oh my God, what's it like to be that person? And what would you feel like if that person reached out to you years later? And that became a know you anywhere. So I'm like, you know, I'm supposed to have ideas, that's my job. And somewhere in the back of my mind, it wasn't so much the Andrea Yates case per se, but it was a piece that Anna Quinlan wrote about Yates. I believe she was working at Newsweek at the time, in which she recounted a story from her own life of being incredibly overburdened, overwhelmed, and having three small children, all three of whom I think were vomiting all the time. And she shows up in her pediatrician's office and she's just at her wit's end. And Quinlan went on to observe that when a woman who's mentally ill kills her children, it's not that mothers identify, it's not that they say that could be me, but it's they see that if they crossed over into mental illness, they understand. They can see how it would happen. And I just thought that was an amazing confession to make publicly, and it sort of stuck with me. So I started reading about Andrea Yates, and there's a lot of stuff I didn't know about Yates. I didn't realize there had been two trials. I didn't realize why the second trial was granted, which is this very interesting little tidbit that I use in the books. I won't spoil it here. And I definitely didn't realize that when, after her second trial, she was found not guilty by reason of postpartum psychosis and was sent, where she stays to this day, to a psychiatric facility as opposed to a prison. She had a roommate who had also killed her child. In a way that's so awful, I just don't say it. It's awful. And the roommate, at one point, was judged to be ready to go back into the world. And she got a job at Walmart. She might have even been the greeter. I don't know that part. She's starting her life over. She's had what I have to say has got to be one of the single worst things that can happen to you happen. And a local TV station publicizes where she works. And people begin flocking there like it's some sort of modern day freak show. I mean, Walmart's not the villain in this. They're like, we can't do business and you can't do your job. And they had to let her go. Now I refer to teaching. One of the ideas I've also developed in teaching is I do think we pretty naturally, as storytellers, tend to sometimes start really close toward cliche. We start toward the stories we're used to. And you have to sometimes step back and think, how do I flip it? How do I surprise people? I felt that stories about women like Andrea Yates and her roommate were not surprising to people. And I also felt that they would traffic in some biases that we hold about people who turn to religion instead of science for answers, which is not something I wanted to delve into. I was like, what if there's a woman who's done this unspeakable thing who says, look at me, regard me, listen to me. I am intelligent, I have money, I have power. I am going to make you listen to my story. I'm going to get in your face, consider me, look at me. And that's when I had the story that became Hush Hush. A woman 10 years ago has killed her child. She has been found not guilty by reason of postpartum psychosis, but there are clearly people who don't quite believe it, who think she got away with something. She fled the country. She relinquished custody of her other two children to her husband at the time. Her husband's remarried, has a new kid. She comes back, determined to make a film about herself and to reestablish contact with those two daughters. And Tess Monaghan has to work for her. And that's the novel. Oh, and then somebody dies. It being a crime novel. I want to speak a little bit about the crime novel. Lately, I actually made the joke that it seems to be almost a new genre of writer profile for the New York Times to write pieces profiling people who seem deeply ashamed to discover that they have written crime novels. I'm a mystery novelist. I've always been very clear about that. And I don't make a case for my own work, because for one thing, I think that's kind of ridiculous and in poor taste. But I also think that's a judgment left to readers and left to the ages about where one's work is going to be classified. But I'm a mystery writer. That's not up for debate. If some reviews have said that my work transcends the mystery genre, I appreciate the well-intentioned compliment. I would argue that my chosen genre is not one that could be transcended. It's not a plane above which we levitate. It is a large and vast and not very well-marked territory with some really interesting stuff going on at the frontiers. But I will never understand the argument that begins that genre, by definition, is lesser. I think the confusion comes back from that old Raymond Chandler, The Simple Art of Murder essay, in which he laid out his vision of the mystery novel. And early in the essay, he says, you know, you've never read a mediocre literary novel because they don't get published. I would beg to differ, but okay. I think his other point, which is better, is that the genre novel can be passable at a level of competence. confident genre novels that get the job done. Nobody considers them art. They're fun, they're fast reads. They do the things that the readers of that genre expect it to do, but no more. But does that mean the genre is defined by its lower limit? Is there any boundary that says, but it can't be better than that? Nick Hornby, writing about Dennis Lehane's Mystic River, said it seemed to him that someone who met all the conventions of a genre novel and managed to write beautiful sentences was like, you know, an angel doing a little tap dance on the head of a pen. And Chandler himself in The Simple Art of Murder, no one ever seems to remember this part, does say that to write a really great crime novel is probably harder than writing a great literary novel. So I don't make the case for myself, I make the case for my genre. And I feel so bad when I meet people who say, oh, I don't read mystery novels. I actually felt bad the other day reading that Anthony Lane review in the New Yorker of 50 Shades of Grey. I didn't read 50 Shades of Grey. I'm not gonna go see the movie. But you know what? For some reason it made 100 million people really happy. And I don't see the need to disparage that or disdain it. Instead, I think it's really interesting because it points out that those 100 million people were not getting what they wanted elsewhere. And you have to, I mean, I think then if you're a really ambitious writer in that genre, you say to yourself, how do I write something that appeals to that baseline reader, but dares to aspire to art? So I'm really bullish on my genre. I had the occasion this week, I have to be careful what I say because I think I actually broke an embargo as an announcement. But I will say that I had the reason to read Margaret Millar's Beast in View. How many people know who Margaret Millar was?
She wrote The Fiend, didn't she?
Yeah. Do you know who her husband, Kenneth Millar, was? If I tell you that her husband's name, Ross McDonald, does that help?
Yes.
Okay. See, this is, it's really kind of a heartbreaker. The Millars were an amazing couple. But she started writing first, she wrote longer, and she wrote more. And her body of work is much more varied. And you look at a book like Beast in View, which was published in 1955, and while it has one element that some people might consider dated, it was very much in the zeitgeist at the time, the primary difference between Beast in View and the books that we're reading now about unreliable narrators, Gone Girl, The Girl on the Train, the primary difference between those books is that they're twice as long. Margaret Millar in 160 pages with language that can make the hair on your neck rise. It is so original and so insightful. Could do more in 160 and 170 pages than probably anyone writing today. And one of the things that fascinates me about the Millars is that our tendency as a culture is to look at these two writers, these two creative types, and want to graft onto them some kind of rivalry. You know, I just think we have this affinity in the US for the, I call it kind of the star is born template. Who's up, who's down, who's the star, who's walking the ocean. If two people in a marriage are creative, one of them must be miserable. Now, this might get kind of personal for me. I'm married to this guy who's done okay for himself. He created a TV show called The Wire. He's done some other stuff for HBO. He's taken very seriously. You know, he's a MacArthur fellow, a so-called genius. You know, he's flown to places that are actually called, like, you know, the Festival of Dangerous Ideas. You know, like 2,000 people come into a stadium to hear him. I don't know what he talks about, something about Marxism and the economy. And one thing I've noticed, and it's become, if you follow me on Twitter or Facebook, you might notice it, he gets profiled. He gets profiled. Like literally 11,000 words in The New Yorker, 6,000 words in the New York Times Magazine. Recently, I think there was a piece on Grantland that ran to 4,000 to 6,000 words. And whenever one of those pieces comes out now, I put the link up like David Simon once again being asked about work-life balance and how it they go, psych! The New York Times Magazine ran 6,000 words about David and never once mentioned whether he had a spouse or a child. It's all about his work. You know, that's a luxury that women just don't have. I mean, even if I were married to someone who is not as visible, I would be asked about my kid, my schedule. I mean, heck, fine, my book's dedicated to my babysitter. What else do you need to know? But it fascinates me because I actually think it shortchanges men. And I think that men, you know, I actually wrote the young man who wrote the most recent profile on my husband, and I said, do you ever consider what it costs someone personally to have to leave his family 5 months to make a television show? I mean, my husband lived in Yonkers Monday through Friday from September through the end of January. Not that Yonkers isn't a lovely place to be, but his family wasn't there. And the writer told me, I don't consider questions like that unless they're relevant to the work. I found that interesting. I found that to be a young man's answer. But at any rate, so I see this in our culture, and the story of the Millars is so very sad. Probably around the time that Margaret Millar found that Beast in View had won the Edgar. I had been nominated for the Edgar, and she would go on to win, which, by the way, is an honor that eluded Ross McDonald. Never won the Edgar for Best Novel. Their daughter, Linda, who was 16 at the time, got in the car, drove, they lived in Santa Barbara, drove to a business district and she bought a bottle of port and she drank it. She bought another bottle of port and drank it and she got in the car and she drove. She hit three people and she killed one, a 13-year-old boy. Ultimately, her case was decided by a judge under the purview of juvenile law. She was given probation, which just made people angrier. They thought the Millars had gotten a sweet deal. She would eventually straighten out her life. She had become a mother. She worked, but her health was never quite good. And Linda Millar died at the age of 31 in her sleep. And I thought, if you know that about Kenneth and Margaret Millar, do you really think who's up or who's down was something I spent a lot of time worrying about? I don't think so. Before I had a kid, I bristled if anyone said that having a kid would change my writing. Now that's because I understood that as a statement that challenged the limits of my imagination, as in, you won't really know until. And that statement still makes me bristle. If you're saying to someone, you can't write about experiences you don't have, you can't write across class lines, you can't write about an age you haven't been, you can't write about a race you're not, you're begging for such a narrow, limited autobiographical fiction that I think the world would be a poorer place for it. But what I did realize is that, of course, it changed me, because everything changes me. Yes, being a mom has forever changed the way I write these novels. That doesn't mean every novel is about being a mom. Heck, having this cold for the past 2 weeks is probably going to change me. You know, look next year to have some person complaining about their cough. Of course I'm changed by every experience I have. I wouldn't have it any other way. How sad not to be changed by your experiences. And so while Hush Hush is the Tess as a mom novel, that doesn't mean they're all going to be Tess as mom novels, which means I'm right back to where I started with the problem of how do I write about Tess Monaghan when she has a small child. And I'm just going to have to keep figuring it out over and over again, although next year's book will not be a test book. Thank you, and I would love to take some questions. Hi.
Hi. I echo your statement about being annoyed with people who don't read mysteries. I think they're missing out. Can I ask you two questions?
Sure.
One, I've read Tess, and I love your non-Tess novels too. The Power of Three, I just adored it, and Want the Dead Know. So, two questions. One, you said you don't use an outline, but you had to for this other one. So, how did you create the outline, and did you find that you weren't able to follow it when you started writing?
How did I create the outline? Well, I always knew what the ending is. So that's actually, I have a general idea of the ending, I guess I should say that. I know where I'm headed. I just don't know all the places I'm going to stop along the way. When I was given the New York Times assignment, I thought probably longer and harder than I should have been about the fact that inevitably, with a serial, I had this image of a man on a plane with week three. He had never read week one or two, and he probably wouldn't read any of the rest. But all he has is the New York Times magazine. He's run out of all other reading material. And here are, 2,500 words of fiction. In a serial, what could possibly get him to read that? And I thought that it would be interesting if I set up for myself the challenge within the challenge, that while every chapter advanced the story, every chapter had a standalone quality to it. Again, I said earlier in the talk, immature writers imitate, mature writers steal. I'm big on stealing. And one of my friends from Eckerd, Ann Hood, had written a novel called The Knitting Club, which was her way of dealing with incredible tragedy that happened to her, that she would later cover as well in the memoir Comfort. And they basically stand up as discrete stories. She did the same thing later in The Red Thread. And there was also a wonderful book by Jill McCorkle called Tending to Ginny, or is it Tending to Virginia, in which people come into the room and, there's someone always has a story to tell. I mean, when you've created this character who can't move, that's an interesting challenge too. And so the idea was that in each chapter someone would tell her a story. And like her dad comes in and tells her the true story of how he met her mom, which she had wrong. And this older woman who works for her, Mrs. Blossom, tells a story about how she met her husband. And there are all these stories about love and marriage and family. And so that was how I found my way through it.
And my second question, I know you you said you research mysteries and even your non-test books, you take a real person and then you build a story differently from where it may have ended up in real life.
Yeah, that's most of my novels are inspired by something that happened in real life.
Right.
But I'm careful to try to delineate, and I think some people think I'm kind of full of it, and they don't accept my own ethical principles on this, my own ethics. I don't want to do ripped from the headlines. Mm-hmm. I don't want to take a case, even, obviously the Andrew Yates case is very, very famous. So I have no desire to write about that. I wouldn't want to write about Susan Smith either, the woman who drowned her two children without being clinically mentally ill. Because I don't want to do that kind of slick, sounds rude, I'm not trying to do that thing where the currency is, we all know the story, but I'm going to pretend I know more about this story. Years ago, there was a horrible case in New York City involving Joel Stein and Hedda Nussbaum,
yes,
and the death of the girl Lisa, who lived with him through an illegal adoption. And the feminist, Susan Brown Miller, who lived in the neighborhood, decided to write a novel taking the bare outlines of that. Now, that's a viable choice, but it's not a choice I want to make because I feel like it keeps the reader in sort of a state of, is this true, is that true? Mm-hmm. Is this true, is that true? I want to leave the facts behind. The book I had out last year, After I'm Gone, was obviously inspired by the disappearance of Julia Salisbury. I had no interest in Julia Salisbury. I had no interest in the real life story of his wife, the wife that I made up for my bookie you know, gambling kingpin was so different. So I'm starting thematically, I guess I would say. The crime interests me because it touches on something that I want to write about, but I'm not trying to play that cat and mouse game. And I know that that's controversial. I have been called out by people, never to my face, only on the internet, where people like, I don't know how you can do this, that's so unfair, I hope you're giving all this money back. Fine, here's a quarter. I think it's just a legacy of having been a reporter. Now, I will tell you that next year's book, which I'm being a little secretive about, while it is very much influenced by sort of a lot of events in current life, it's actually a retelling of an American classic. It's sort of me taking a very well-known story, putting it in a different time and place, and then, which is Columbia, Maryland in 1980, and then coming in 35 years later with sort of this new zeitgeist that informs the way we see things in a way we didn't used to see things. Could I be more vague?
You almost answered the question which I didn't really ask, which was if you had, in your research, have you ever come across a crime, maybe unsolved? You didn't write about it, but you felt you were really motivated to try and figure it out as the reporter that you used to be?
No, I am so uninterested in solving real life crimes. I do tend to be someone who is the obvious answer is the obvious answer. So when Serial was interesting, everyone so much interest to people, it really wasn't my cup of tea. I don't know, I didn't get kind of like reporting in public. I felt like you should do all the reporting and have an opinion. And if the reporter had reached the conclusion that that young man was truly innocent, as opposed to did not get a fair trial, which are kind of two different things sometimes. Although, let me be clear, if someone did not get a fair trial, they deserve to win on that appeal. You know, that's the bedrock of our. But, you know, to me it's like, okay, what's the more likely thing that happened? How do most women die in homicide? Yeah, domestic violence at the hands of someone who knows them. And that is more likely to be the answer than, you know, that maybe serial killer who was on the loose for 2 key weeks in Maryland who had another Asian victim. I mean, I just tend to be like, the obvious answer is probably, I might have been around too many cops. I was supposed to like cops by my husband. Yes, sir.
Thank you. The Daughter of Time is still one of the neatest mystery stories ever, and if Inspector Grant and Josephine Tay inspired you, you should be doing just fine with this
book. I guess steal from the best, you know?
Do you have any sense where the current investigation of the Lyon sisters is going?
No. You know, I've always, I came to that case from my memories as a teenager. Right. From my memory of that poster. It was in the deli in Wildlake Village in Columbia, Maryland. And I was driving past Wheaton Plaza when I remembered it. And what caught my imagination was that there were two of them. And I was like, right. How do you get two girls to go with you? I mean, there are, and that was it for me. My primary thought on the developments in the Lyon case is I don't even dare speak for the parents, but I think it would probably be I think they would prefer a definitive answer than an open question. And if we could ever get to a definitive answer, I think that would be great. I would love to see that. But I don't know. Any other questions? Everyone feel a little little shy tonight. It was so cold. Everyone just so over this. It's like I saw the sign at the bus stop with 23 days to spring. Well, if there are no more questions, I'm really happy to sign books. Thank you for coming out.